Thank you for WBD sir inviting BHL for this 8th national seminar on FGD. Here we'll see. Here will be the interesting topics like what will be the market global market scenario for the FGD. Then we'll see the what is the brief on the MEF norms. Then what is the global technology available for this capture of this SO2. And the BHL, what technology we are adapted for this thermal power plant. And we'll see the comparison of technology, which one is a superior, which is a inferior. And we'll see which one is the most appropriate process for the Indian thermal power plants. And we know we have executing many FGD orders for last 2 years. And what are the challenges we are facing during the execution of these erections and in the time of like installations. So this is a curve survey done by one company called McKay in 2018. If you see here, from the 2009 up to 2016, there's a decreasing trend in the FGD. In all our country, other countries, they have installed FGD and it's saturated and the count of the FGD has been calmed down. After this 2015, the December 2015, you can see after the 16 and 17 that the trend again started. So this trend has been increased only because that the FGD business has come to in India. The jump, if you're seeing, the jump is around 2.6% jump over the last 2011. So now the trend, the market in the FGD has been increased gradually. And the jump is drastic, it is 2.6 times. These are the one more survey where those are done by the McKay. You are seeing these are the common columns, FGD suppliers. The one of the suppliers is like Mitsubishi Hitachi Power System, and wherever they are having the market share of 61.5% market share. And one more thing we want to tell you here, the BHL, we are having collaboration with Mitsubishi Hitachi Power System. And the collaboration is valid for the 15 years. So if you're seeing the survey, till 2018, Mitsubishi Hitachi Power, they're having the market share of 20 gigahertz plant. They have captured a market, which is comprised of 34 units. So in this, the Indian project is also covered, which BHL has secured the orders. So as already everybody has covered the norms, just briefly touched the norms. These are the norms we have done comparison with our country. Last one is our country with Chinese, European and Europe country. So if you're seeing here, all of a sudden in other countries, gradually the norms has been decreased from 1,500, then 200, then 100. Whereas in the India, there was no norms. We used to control the SO2 by increasing the height of the chimney. All of a sudden, December 2015, the norms has come and we have to maintain the norms of 100 milligram. So basically, any height of the chimney in power plant, no, it will be calculated based on this formula. H is equal to 14 into Q to the power 0.3. The Q is nothing but the sulfur generated in the furnace. So based on that, we will decide what is the height of the chimney is required. So typically, if you're seeing for 210 and 250 megawatt or less than 500, the height of the chimney will be 220 meter. Where in the case of like the plant which is greater than 500 and above, the height of the chimney will become 275 meter. This is the scenario before 2015. And this is the scheme before the norms has been implemented. From the like furnace, first pass, it goes to second pass, it goes to the APH, then ESP, then IDF, and it goes to the stack. This scheme is similar for your subcritical and supercritical. There is no control for the NOx and SOx. Only for the particulate matter depends upon the site condition that CA has given some guidelines to be maintained the particulate emission. It will go 150, 100, and depends upon the customer requirement. So these are the norms after December 2015 given by the MOF, climate change. So here we'll briefly see only the second row, the SO2. The plant which is installed before December 2003 and the plant which is installed between January 2004 till December 2016, this is the norms. Less than 500, 600 milligram. Greater than equal to 500, it should be 200 milligram. And the plant hereafter, which is going to be commissioned after January 2017, the norms is very stringent. It is 100 milligram. So as already the previous speakers explained, there is a constraint in the water requirement also. The existing plant, they are given up to the water requirement of 3.5 meter cube per hour per megawatt. And the plant which is going to be installed after January 2017, it is further stringent. The norms is 2.5 meter cube per hour per megawatt. It is changed to 3. Okay, sir, there is a revision. So now is the 2.5 will become now 3. So now you see, we are putting the FGD now. After putting FGD, we don't require that much height of the chimney, no? The height of the chimney can be reduced now. Because basically the height of the chimney depends on your SO2. The SO2 you are going to capture in FGD. So the formula has been revised by the CE. So this is a revised formula what they are given. H is equal to 6.902 Q into 0.277 to the power of 0.555. So after this norms has come in India, then you see how many changes happen in the scheme of the power plant. So these are the changes. So from the second pass, normally it go to the APH. Now where it is going? It is going to the SCR. So SCR is also required to capture the NOx. It is one of the technology where they inject the ammonia, and with the catalyst of titanium vanadium, they will capture the ammonia, and they will capture the NOx. Then after that, you'll go to the ESP. Then after the ESP, we are having ID fan. And in between the ID fan and chimney, we will be keeping our FGD. So SO2 will be get captured in the FGD, and then in clean gas will get it to the stack. So we'll see now the technology. Globally, some few technology we have listed out here, what is available globally in the world. If you're seeing here, this is a dry FGD. So this dry FGD will be installed before the ESP. So this is the best suited for the industrial boilers or a cement factories. The plant which is a lesser capacity of 250 megawatt, less than 250 megawatt. Because the dry FGD, the volume of the gas, it cannot be handled huge volume. So it's the best suited for the plant which is less than 250 megawatt. And here constraint is it will best if you are already having a space for before the ESPs. In some of the plant, if you're seeing in between the APH and the ESP, there will not be any space. So that also we have to see in the layout constraint whether we are able to keep this dry FGD in the plant. So next is in the dry FGD, it is the flue gas will come here. Your SO2, we will be spraying your limestone, whatever with the reagent here. Here, the main process is adsorption. It is not an absorption, it is an adsorption. Your SO2 will be attached on your ash particle along with your limestone and will get collected in the ESP or back filter. Then in the few dust will be get recirculated in the process, and some will be goes to the dryer and will go out to as a disposal. So these are the process already explained by the previous speaker, that they will be preparing the limestone slurry, and from the limestone slurry we are putting into the system as a reagent. So this is one more technology we called CFBC, circulating fluidized bed. So here the previous one is a dry FGD, only the limestone will be get added up. Here it is like a fluidized bed. You would have heard that BC boilers. So limestone will be used in the combustion, in the furnace to capture your SO2. The principle is the same here. So we'll be putting your SO2 here. Your SO2 will be captured because of the adsorption. Then the clean gas will go to the back filter, then goes to the stack. So these are the system for preparing the reagents. Now we'll see the most important one. Next is ammonia based. This is also one of the technology will be used for to capture the SO2 in the flue gas. It is not known actually. Only the a few plants only they have installed, and it is not that much success. So if you're seeing here the process, from the gas normally go to the stack. What we are doing, we are putting one booster fan. Your booster fan, I think you are aware that to push the flue gas from one place to another, you require some pressure. The pressure will be generated by your ID fan, normally in the power plant. In the case of FGD, it will be generated by the booster fan. Working principle is the same. Only the thing is the pressure developed by both the fan will be different. The volume handled by both the fan will be the same. So now the pressure will be developed, it will go to the scrubber. So before the removing the SO2, they are having one main scrubber. This is your pre-scrubber. So you know after the ESP, there will be some particulate always will be there. So in the case of ammonia FGD, directly the flue gas cannot go to the main scrubber. They want to wash the ash before going to the main scrubber. So they are putting on pre-scrubber. Then SO2 will go to the main scrubber. Your SO2 will be get scrubbed. Then after in the main process, they require some wet ESP also. Then it go to the stack. So this is a wet limestone based, similar working business. Wet limestone based FGD also we are having same scheme. So you keep on recirculating. In the main process, they are telling they are forming some byproducts like ammonium sulfates. But here the ammonium sulfate directly we cannot use as a fertilizer. After that, it has to go to the some further processing. to use as a fertilizer. This is a wet limestone based FGD system where in the this is a the current trend in India. Maximum all the customers they have preferring to go with the wet limestone based FGD. Here the scheme is almost similar, like it is having after the ID fan normally goes to the stack. So what we are doing here, this is a typical scheme for the NTPC projects. All the NTPC they are going for the new stack, and this is a scheme is similar for all the NTPC projects. If you are seeing here, from the ID fan it goes to the booster fan, your pressure will be boost up, then it goes to the scrubber. So you in the scrubber you will be removing the SO2. How we will be removing? We are removing we are putting this slurry from the bottom, we are taping taking from this pump and we're spraying over the hot gas. New SO2 in the will be get captured here and the clean gas will go to the new stack. And this system we call as a flue gas system. This enter system we call as a limestone grinding system, because limestone, you know, it is not available in powder form, it is available in rock form. So we have to use the crusher and the mill, we have to crush the limestone. And then using this wet ball mill, we are preparing the slurry. From the slurry, it is storing the tank. And as and when required in the system, we are pushing into the system. So enter system we call as a limestone grinding system. And once the gypsum is getting produced here, this enter system we call as a gypsum dehotting system. Because once the gypsum is produced, gypsum slurry, we cannot throw directly the dry the slurry. Na? So basically, we require the solid and liquid separation. So solid and liquid separation will be done by in this process. So when the gypsum slurry is produced through the pump, we are putting in the hydrocyclone. Hydrocyclone, as already explained, it's a separation of fine and coarse particle. So fine will be goes on the overflow and coarse will come into the underflow. This is your vacuum bell filter where your slurry will get sucked in the bottom and the dry gypsum at the top with 10% moisture will get stored in the shed. And the main process, the fine flow will further go to the second stage of separation. Further fine and coarse will get separated. And the minimum amount of water will go to the ash pond. And the liquid and the underflow will come to this filtered water tank. And from this tank, it will again back to the absorber as a makeup water. So this is a typical scheme for the FGD. Now we'll see the seawater based FGD. And it is a preferable where the plant we are having one through condenser. And the plant which is located to the coastal area. Because in the process, if you're seeing, we require huge amount of water. Typically, if you're seeing 1660 megawatt of plant, 1 lakh meter cube of water is required, where the 40% of water will be required, like 40% means 40,000 of water will be required to remove the SO2. Balance 60% of water will be required to neutralize your acid, right? So if you're seeing here, I've shown here GGH. GGH is nothing but your APH. You are seeing the APH in air preheater. Here is also same. In APH, you are having heat transfer from hot gas to the air side, where here the heat transfer will become untreated to the treated side. So the flue gas, untreated flue gas will be goes to the booster fan, then goes to the GGH, then goes to the absorber. So you know the temperature of flue gas after the APH will be around 140, 150 degree. So 140, 150 will goes to the GGH, then after the GGH, your temperature will become 90. So the temperature of 40 to 50 degree is captured in a GGH. Then the 90 degree flue gas temperature goes into the absorber. So what we are doing here, we are spraying the water over the SO2. So when you are spraying the water, your flue gas will become saturated. We call adiabatic saturation. The saturation temperature will become 50 to 60 degree normally. So after your SO2 is removed, the flue gas will come out here. So your temperature will become 50 to 55 degree. Now it is a acid dew point temperature we used to call. It is a, because we are not removing all the SO2, no? Depends upon MOF norms, depends upon the life of the plant. We are capturing 600 milligram or 200 milligram, 100 milligram. So when it comes out, there is some SO2 is also there. There is a chance of flue gas to be corrosion, because also there is a chance of acid to be formed in the duct. So that is the purpose of GGH will come here. It will be transferred from the heat from untreated to treated. So delta T of, now we have captured out of 40 to 50 degree will transfer to the treated side. So the outlet of the treated will become greater than 90 degree. So you know the dew point of your sulfur, 90 degree. Any power plant you are taking, they will design your duct and your boiler greater than 90 degree, because the temperature, the dew point of your sulfur is 90, and your water dew point is become 50 or 55 degree. When both will be in same temperature, your acid will get formed. When it is when your SO2 temperature is above your sulfur dew point, means your water dew point temperature, there will not be any formation of acid. So that is why we are increasing the temperature of the outlet of the GGH, then it go to the stack. Whenever GGH is there, we call stack as a dry stack, because the temperature of the flue gas is 90 degree above your water dew point temperature. If a previous scheme, if you're seeing, has shown there is a no GGH. So the temperature of outlet of the your absorber is 50 to 55 degree. That is a water dew point temperature. So that is a we call as a wet stack. Whenever GGH is not there, we call stack as a wet stack. Whenever GGH is there, we call stack as a dry stack. In the process, I mean, in the case of seawater, the water will be get diverted from the condenser. It goes to the one sump. From the through the pump, we are spraying over the gas. So this is a 40% of water will be get diverted here. Once you are removing the SO2, your liquid become acid. So we cannot throw the acid to the sea, na. So in the mean process, what you are doing is pH lower water, untreated means waste water will come to the aeration blower. Here from the condenser, 60% of water we are adding here. We are neutralizing this low pH water. Now in this mean process, we are adding the oxygen. So when the oxygen is getting added up, then we are diluting in the dilution basin, then it goes to the sea. This is the process of seawater based FGD. So just I will just briefly touch the technology BHL is adapted. We have acquired from the Mitsubishi. So we having collaboration for both the technology, wet limestone based FGD and seawater based FGD. Wet limestone based FGD, ours is a unique technology. We will not spray from the top to bottom. We will spray from bottom to top. Your flue gas will entry here. And we will be sucking the slurry from the through the pump and spraying over the gas. So and then here the slurry will be sprayed from bottom to top. Here what will happen? The slurry flue gas will come and rise up here. In the mean process, your SO2 will get captured and the clean gas will go through the stack and your the low pH water, whatever may be, that will get collected in the bottom of the tank. This is a closed circuit. The circuit will be goes for 3 to 4 cycles. Where in the case of seawater, it is a once through, once the sea water from the condenser will come, SO2 will get captured and will again back to the sea. But in the case of wet limestone, you are having a byproduct as a gypsum. But in the case of seawater, there is no byproduct. Based on the like a sulfur content, your technology will get vary. So up to the 97% removal efficiency, we are going for the single tower DCFS. DCFS is nothing but we call as a double contact flow scrubber. Why the MHPS, the Japanese has named this technology double contact? If you're seeing here, the flue gas is coming and rise up here. And you spray from bottom to top. When the slurry is going up and your flue gas is going up, it have contact, co-current will be there. And in particular the spray height, what will happen? The slurry will become fall down because of gravity. So that time it will have a counter current. So it have a double contact with the flue gas. So that is why the Japanese has named this technology as a DCFS. So whenever the efficiency is required more than 97, we'll go for the twin tower. How we are in the boiler, we are having first pass, second pass. Same fashion we are having your first pass and second pass. The flue gas will be entering the first tower. Your 30 to 40% of SO2 will get captured. Then we'll take turn here and balance SO2 will get captured here. Then it goes to the stack. So basically we are increasing the retention term of flue gas so that you can capture the more SO2 in the absorber. Because here it is a unique advantage, like all the pumps are connected on common header. It's a single spray based on your boiler load. Suppose boiler is not working in the 100% load. It is not running 100% TMs here. It is running at 50 or 60% load. So that time like all your pumps are connected to one common header. You can switch off your RC pumps. If you're seeing here, the major auxiliary power consumption in FGD is your auxiliary pump. So you can switch off one or two pumps. So you can control your spray height. And based on the, because load is not much now, because boiler is running in 60% or 50% load. So you don't require this much height of slurry. This much slurry is not required. So slurry can be lowered by switch off the pumps. And you aware that limestone is a sticky property, is a sticky in nature. If you're not keeping in suspension, it will go and clog and you will get settled in the bottom of the tank. And it's very difficult to dislodge limestone. So in all, like in the FGD system, we are having 7 to 8 tanks. All the tanks we require agitators. Where in our case, we don't require any agitators. So what we are doing here, with high pressure jet air, we are putting into the system. And we are keeping the slurry in suspension through the air. Wherein we'll be keeping the slurry, and these are the RC pumps which are connected to the common headers. So we require only agitator when your plant is not running. So that time your agitator, this oxidation blower will not work. So that time only we require this agitator to be in operations. Unless normal operation, this agitators are not required. So these are the our typical internals, how the spray we are doing inside the absorbs. So these are the spray pipes and these are the spray nozzles. The spray pipes is made up of FRP coated with silicon carbide, because silicon carbide is required because it is abrasion inside. Because the slurry is falling, there is a corrosion, abrasion will be there. So definitely coating inside the FRP is required here. And the nozzles. The nozzles are made up of silicon carbide. I think this already sir has explained, I need not touch here. As sir has told already, the required, if you are having very optimum and fineness at the particle at the outlet of your hydroxyglone, you will have a very effective removal of your SO2. So this, as sir has already explained, I just briefly explain you. Based on your SO2 load, we can change the speed of your feeding. How much SO2 is coming from the boiler, it is fully auto control. We can adjust the wave feeder. It is similar to your coal bunker. If you're seeing the power plant, you're having coal bunker, no? Similarly, we're having one limestone bunker and we're having a wedge feeder. So based on the SO2 load, you can control your feed. And this is a ball mill. It will be rotate the speed of like 10 to 20 RPM. The ball having different sizes, it will vary from 10 to 40 mm. The ball mill goes up and because of gravity, again fall down. So there will be collision between the ball to ball. In between, you're having limestone will be get crushed and slurry will be get will be passed to the sleeve. Trunnion we called, and we'll collect it in the mill, and then we'll go to the hydrocyclone. Because in the mill, you will not get the required fineness. As sir told, we got 90% a pass of 325 mesh. You cannot get the discharge of the mill. So for that only we require your hydrocyclone. So hydrocyclone we use to separate the fine and coarse. Fine will go as a byproduct, and the coarse again back to the as a mill as a, for the further grinding. Recirculation, yeah. You see, this is a recirculation line, sir. Additional supply will be there, sir. Based on initial setting, we will be doing based on the boiler, how much SO2 is coming from the boiler. After that, based on the how much SO2 is going out of the FGD. They are having a backward control. Two controls are there, sir. One is a feed backward control, feed forward control. Feed forward is you are getting signal how much SO2 is coming from the boiler flue gas. Based on that, you will feed setting the VFD. Another is after the FGD, you require 100 milligrams, suppose. So based on that, further control will be done based on the recirculation and inlet feed. This is your dewatering system. How the gypsum is getting produced. Once this gypsum is getting formed, how we have to be get separated. So gypsum from the absorber will go to the two stage of separation. We having primary and secondary separation. So here gypsum is nothing but like 70% of water and 30% you are solid. The solid is nothing but we call it the gypsum slurry. So it goes here fine and coarse get separated. Coarse will come here. This is we call as a vacuum belt filter. Is it similar to your belt feeders? You having two rollers, over roller you having rubber, and over you having porous cloth. In the bottom of the vacuum belt filter, we having vacuum pump. So you are creating vacuum pressure in the bottom. So what will happen? We are creating vacuum pressure. Your water will get sucked. Well, get set and dry gypsum will be at the top and collected in the shed. And the water which is gets collected through the pump will store in the filtered water tank. And then from there it go to the absorber as a makeup water. If you're seeing, I've shown in my scheme, GGH and without GGH. The temperature which is coming after the GGH, I told, is a 90 degree. When it enters into the absorber, after the absorber, it is a 50 degree. So in the mean process, the temperature is reduced. How it is reduced? Because we are adding water. When you are adding water, it means it is evaporating. So you have to keep on adding your water. So that water, we have recirculated from this tank. And in the case of GGH is not there, some cases. So in that, the directly 150 degree after the APH will be there. Same temperature will enter into the absorber. So in that case, your water consumption will be more because 150 directly entering, outlet temperature is a fixed because the saturation temperature of water is a fixed at the outlet absorber. That is 50 or 55 degree. Inlet temperature is 150. Then water consumption will become double. So whenever GGH is there, the water will be half. Whenever GGH is not there, the water consumption will be double. Typically, if you're taking 660 megawatt, with GGH, the water consumption is 70 meter cube per hour. Without GGH, it has become 140, 150 meter cube per hour. So we have done some comparison of technologies. First one I already explained is this ours. We are having a single stage of spray. All the recirculation pump connected to one common header, and we are spraying from bottom to top. Yes, yes, yes. I will tell you. And second one is a conventional type, where others is our GE is having, ISJEC is having this type of technologies, and MH, they will be spray from top to bottom. We'll spray from bottom to top, and they're having multi-spray levels. Depend upon your SO2 load, they will decide the number of spray levels. And they're having each spray level, they're having each recirculation pump will be there of different head, because head is varying, no? So when head is varying, the configuration of pump will get vary here. Where in our case, all the pump configuration will become same because we are having only single spray level. Third one is a very unique technology where L&T is having. They're having a tie-up with Chiyoda, Japan. They don't have this recirculation pump. They will not spray over the hot gas. What they are doing, from the fan, your booster fan, we are taking the untreated gas through the orange color is there. No? This week they call it a sparger. Through the this, the flue gas is passing through the sparger, and it is passing through the tank. This is a slurry, limestone slurry filled with the tank. The SO2 will pass into the tank. They are creating here bubble here. Then in the meantime, your SO2 will get captured, and the clean gas through the maroon. Sir, basically, this technology is based on your absorber. How effectively you are spraying it, that is. Your upstream and downstream, there is no change. Your downstream will be the same for all the technology. How we are shown that scheme, no, sir, dewatering. That scheme and limestone preparation will be the same for all the technologies. Only based on their like experiments, the fineness may vary. Like we require 90% of 325 mesh. They may require 95% of 325. So that particulate site may vary, but the upstream and downstream equipments will not vary. Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, yes. Yes, yes. We can capture, yes. Sir, basically, the technology is like if your SO2 is more, you have to size your absorber suitably based on your SO2 concentration and your flue gas. So the size will get vary. If concentration your inlet is more, then size of the absorber will goes up. That's it. Efficiency will be the same. Then efficiency will be decided by your inlet only, sir. Because outlet is fixed by government now. It is 100 milligram or 200 or 600. Inlet depends upon what where from the coal you are using it and how much is the sulfur content. So this I need not explain, already explain you. This comparison of ammonia versus wet limestone. Wet limestone, I'll explain already what are the advantages. We having gypsum, which can be used as already sir has explained you the advantage of the gypsum as a byproduct. Ammonia, in the cost-wise, wet limestone is economic in compared to the ammonia-based FGD. Because I told you, we required here a pre-scrubber, which is a costlier. And you know the storage of ammonia is one more question mark for us. The ammonia storage is not that much easy. The ammonia which we are storing and transportation and all, that we have to be has to be taken care when we are going for the ammonia. And this technology is not that much proven worldwide. Only like one or two plants are there. Sir, if you are seeing this, you will understand what is the FGD here. First one is a seawater, second one is a limestone. Basically, no, sir, for removing your SO2, we don't record any technology here. If you are putting water over your SO2 will get captured here. Because you know what is acid drain, no, sir? How the acid drain is getting formed. When your SO2 is coming out of your chimney, suppose there is a rain. Rain is having H2O. It will react with water, it will form acid drain. Same, it happened naturally there. Wherever here we have, artificially we are creating here. That is the only difference here. So if you're seeing here, first reaction, SO2 is reacting with water. It never react with the limestone or anything else. First it will react in water, it will form your acid. This H plus your acid and your HSO3. So if you're seeing a second, this HSO3 is a highly unstable. It can be react with any further ions. So to balance the reaction, we are adding the oxygen here. So it will become SO4, these are the acids. So when you are spraying your SO water here, the clean gas is going out, then this tank is filled with acid. So this pH, this low pH, we cannot throw it out, no? So that is a purpose we are keeping here. Limestone will get added up here. So that is a we are adding the limestone. How the SO2 is first react with H2O? Na? Similar fashion, limestone also will react with water. It will form calcium and bicarbonates and OH ions. Basically, I require this one. This we call as a bicarbonate. This is an alkali and this is an acid. So I want to add both so it will become neutral. Understand? A limestone is required only to neutral my acid here. So in here, the limestone react with water will form neutral. Where in the case of seawater, already in the seawater, enormous number of bicarbonates are available. So I don't require limestone there. So directly we will get neutral in the case of seawater. Where in the case of limestone, artificially we are creating the bicarbonates. That is the difference between the wet limestone and seawater based FGD. So once it get bicarbonates is getting formed, so then this bicarbonates will react with acid. This is your acid, will react with bicarbonate, will form neutral here, H2O and CO2. So overall reaction we are seeing here, in the mean process you are forming CSO4.2HO. This we call as a gypsum, as a byproduct. Where in the case of seawater, there is no gypsum here. So this is a survey done by one of McKay company, and what is the most appropriate process for globally if you are seeing? They have told that wet limestone based gypsum is 90% worldwide, the plant, all the thermal plant they are using 97. And dry and semi-dry FGD will be gone for 4%. If you are having a space in between the APH and ESP, and there is no layout constraint, we can think if you are having less than 200 or less than 250 megawatt. And seawater based FGD, since seawater quantity is required, more huge quantity, wherever you have once through condenser, already you are having condenser to cool your steam, same water can be diverted to the FGD to remove the SO2. If you want to put a new intake seawater, then the cost of your intake will be more than your FGD cost. So wherever you are having once through condenser, it is preferred to go to the seawater based FGD. So these are the challenges what we are facing today. Just 2 minutes. So these are the challenges what we are facing today. Actually, we are executing around 51 FGDs as of now, FGD. Like 20 FGD projects we are executing with a collaboration with Mitsubishi. Issue is like all the tenders, they want this material. This is one of the very costliest and imported material. In India, this material is not available. We call it as a clad sheet. This clad is nothing but the material is made up of C276. It is we call as a hast alloy. In a hast alloy, we are not manufacturing this material. We have been importing from the US, and there is no source from the India. So if you're seeing in all our tenders, customer is indicating this clad sheet. So if a supply minimum customer is asking a supply time of 10 to 12 months, supply time is itself is 10 to 12 months. So after supply, what you have to do some fabrication. No? I have to do some stiffness, some welding and all I have to do at my workshop. Then after that, I have to do the erection of the, will begin 4 to 6 months. So if you're taking my project schedule is 20 months or 24 months, where the government has given up to 2022, it is very difficult to maintain that schedule with this costliest material. Because all we are depending, globally facing only 3 or 4 vendors are available. In China, there is 2 vendors. In Japan, 1 vendor is there. In US, 1 vendor is there. So, and 1 Korean, 1 vendor is there. So with this vendor, this much of huge demand, we are not going to be meet. So we are having some small suggestion here. It is a well proven in the power plant. Even you ask other FGD collaborator vendors, they will also suggest the same material. There is a one material we call glass flake lining. This material is very cheaper. It is available in India. And the life of the material is like 15 to 20 years. If you're seeing the old power plant, no, already the life 5 to 10 is over. Balance another 20 years or 15 years is going to be run. For that plant, we need not invest this clad material. We can go for the glass flake lining. And it is very easier. You can supply 1 to 2 months and the application in the site will be 2 to 3 months. It is like a spraying, like a paint. Very faster we can do at the site. So, and the life is 15 to 20 years. So in compare, like this one is a supply time, we cannot get clad sheet. And second is the your erection time and schedule, we cannot meet it. So next, some of the tender also we have seen, you are giving the bolted connection. You know, all the plants, what we are doing is a retrofit. There is a space constraint. You know, behind the chimney, there is no space. we have to locate the space through the FGD, and we have to reroute our ducting in such a way it not fall the existing facility. In that, you are giving some bolted connection of the structures. It's very difficult because in the site, we cannot assume that we don't know what is going under the ground and all. Or we can see that is a structure, we can reroute our ducting and all. Where in the underground, we don't know. So suppose when you're doing some erection, there is a, something is then in the underground, we have to be relocate our columns. In the case of bolted, very difficult. Even 10 mm shift, you cannot do the erection there. If it is like a welding connection, it can be done very easily. So our suggestion is you can give an option of a welding connection so that erection can be done very fast. And you well aware, welding the erection time will be very shorter. And third one is, in all, we're having some critical equipments like wet ball mills are there. You are having recirculation pump, oxidation boiler, gypsum dewatering, vacuum bell filter. All the tendons, customers are mentioning the QR, qualification. It means you have already supplied this system, then only you can supply for the FGD plant. So if you're seeing in India, there is a many vendors are available, which they have not done for the FGD, but there are similar application they have done. Example, if you're digging mill, they have done for many iron ores. Same application there, but they are not done for the limestone. Limestone also done, but they are not done for the FGD application. Even though they have capability, they are done, they are not qualifying because of this qualification. So we request you to viable this qualification, show that our Indian vendors can supply this material, and we will have some cost benefit over that, and we will promote our government of India, given the make in India concept initiative. Also, it will help to make the promote our make in India initiative. Thank you. Any doubts are there? We will discuss in the panel discussion. Thank you, sir.